Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. He says, lest any root, doesn't matter which one, any root. As we talked this morning about the heart, the matter of the heart, is dealing with the fact that the Word of God is supposed to, it's intended to get down in our heart and take root there. And when it does, well, if it does, if we don't have the hearts that we spoke of earlier, if you don't have a stony heart, if you don't have a solid heart, if you allow the Word of God to really get in there and settle in and take root, then it'll accomplish something beneficial. But he says here, lest any root. And so there are other things, and we talked about them. One of the things, or a couple, two, three of the things that God said might take root along with the Word of God and ultimately choke it out would be the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, the gonna have pleasure, that's for sure. Those things will stymie the Word of God. And so, as it even says here, lest any root, and they're varied as to what it might be, but it's specifically a root of bitterness. In other words, something that ticks you off, something that you will not forgive, something that you're just going to drag around with you day in, day out. It could be a variety of different things, but it's any root. Anything that you allow to get in there and take root, but its ultimate is bitterness. He says, once that's done, oh, you might suppress it for a while. You might put on a happy face now and then. And by the way, I think you should. I think if you come to church and you've got a real bitter spirit about you, you ought to try and just downplay it as much as possible. Put on a happy face, because nobody wants to see a bitter attitude on the part of anyone. But he says, if that exists, it's only a matter of time, bitterness is going to spring up and trouble you. Most of the time, bitterness doesn't really impact the person that you're angry with. They don't care. They're not fazed by it at all. They could care less if you're angry with them. You're holding a grudge against them. The one that it impacts is you. He says it springs up and troubles you, but then look at this part. And thereby many be defiled. See, to me, that's the most tragic part of sin in our lives. Not so much how it impacts us, because it's our sin. David said, against thee, thee only have I sinned and done. So he recognized that it was his sin. But notice also that David's sin didn't just impact him. It impacted many other individuals, some in his own family, some throughout the whole kingdom. And so that's the real tragedy when your sin, when my sin impacts other people. Now, with that said, that's the warning. That's the point that God is trying to drive home here in this text. He said, you've got to be careful about things that you don't let go. The Bible says, let not the sun go down upon your wrath. If you're angry and bitter and you've just got this malicious attitude that you want to get even and be vengeful towards somebody, watch out, because you may go to bed and wake up in the morning and have forgotten momentarily about it, but it's still in there. And it's only going to take something to cause it to spring up and trouble you and defile others. And one person, of course there's many in the Word of God and probably many that you know, many that I know, that have been impacted by harboring a root of bitterness. But one specifically in the Word of God that I want to look at here tonight is back in the book of Ruth. And so if you take a look back there, Ruth chapter number 1, well, here's a man, it says in verse number 2, the name of the man was Elimelech. Elimelech and the name of his wife, Naomi. And the name of his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. I think it's by accident that God put in there, and they continued there. Oh, we promised we're only going to sojourn, but God said, yeah, but it turned into continuing there. They could have gone in, gone to the general store and left, but they didn't. And it says Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died. Imagine dying in a far country. A lot of people do, you know. We talk about the prodigal. And the prodigal is that great success story, how we think, oh boy, oh, it's so wonderful when they come home. Well, a lot of them die in a far country. Elimelech is one of them. Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left, and her two sons. Well, at least I have my two boys. It can't get much worse than this. Oh, no? And they took them wives of the women of Moab. Oh, what'd you go and marry those two for? I mean, it's bad enough. My husband died. And now my boys, my two boys, marrying those heathen women. Oh, God. Can it get worse? Yeah. The name of the one was Orpah, the other Ruth, and they dwelled there about 10 years. Boy, it just keeps going, doesn't it? They were going to sojourn there, but then they continued there, and then they were there about 10 years. Take you farther than you want to go. And Mahlon and Chilion died. Oh. Now put yourself in Naomi's shoes there for a second. My husband died. My two sons marry these two heathen women. Then my two sons died. And what am I stuck with? Two heathen daughters-in-law. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Well, she should have known that to begin with. She was living in the house of bread. She should have been praising the God that satisfied, that is the bread of life. But it was only a matter of time if she'd have just waited it out, if she'd have lived by faith. The just shall live by faith. If she'd have done that, God probably would have supplied her need, right? I think I've read that in the Bible somewhere. But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But see, we don't want to wait on God. And so we want to go and satisfy our need. Whose fault is this? Wherefore she went out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her, and they went on their way to return unto the land of Judah. And Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, go, return each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you as ye have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that ye may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice and wept. And they said unto her, surely we will return with thee unto thy people. And Naomi said, turn again, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Turn again, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have an husband. She's looking at this. She's in a hopeless, desperate situation now. The only thing she's got left is these two heathen daughters-in-law, and she says, you two might as well go home too. Well, I want you to take a look down in verse number 19. It says, so the two went until they came to Bethlehem. Well, let me just back up just for a second, because maybe you're not familiar with the story here. Orpah, they're both Moabites. Orpah, she says, you know what? Matter of fact, if you take a look there, let's see. Look at verse number 14. And they lifted up their voice and wept again, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. And she said, behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. Why, even after 10 years, after 10 years, I got news for you, folks. Let me tell you this and mark it down. You may think, well, I'll marry them, or I'll associate with them, and I'll bring them around, and they'll get saved, and we'll all live happily ever after. But after 10 years down there, she still is willing to go back to her people and to her gods. But thankfully, Ruth, on the other hand, Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go. And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people and thy God my God. By the way, you'll find her in the genealogy of Jesus Christ too. Imagine that, a heathen Moabite. But let's see here. As I said, you look in verse 19, so that they too went, who's the two? Ruth and Naomi. So they're heading back to Bethlehem, Judah. It says they came to Bethlehem, and it came to pass when they were come to Bethlehem that all the city was moved about them, and they said, is this Naomi? Is this Naomi? Those she had formerly known were very surprised to see her. Now, we don't know why they asked that question, is this Naomi? Perhaps they were, maybe they were in contempt of, what do you think you're doing coming back here? Maybe that was their attitude. Maybe they were asking out of curiosity. Maybe they said, is that Naomi? Or maybe they were asking out of genuine concern. Maybe they looked at her and said, oh my. Are you Naomi? Oh, she changed, all right. Point number one tonight, the noticeable change. The noticeable change. Is this Naomi? See, there was a change in her appearance. No doubt her brow was wrinkled. No doubt her body was wearied. No doubt she had, it had taken its toll on her. A lot of things had occurred in her life. She lost her husband, married off her two sons, her two darling sons, to a couple of heathen women. And then they turn around and die on top of it. And then still, she's thinking, what do I have left? I might as well go back. Might as well go back. But one thing that they noticed a change in her. And the change that they noticed, the Bible says in Proverbs 13:15, the way of transgressors is hard. And if you haven't seen that, I certainly have. I've seen some people. As a matter of fact, they even said that about Jesus, you know. Remember, he talked about that. He said in John chapter number 8, he said, before Abraham was, I am. And they thought to themselves, what are you talking about? Thou art not even 50 years old. Surprising, Jesus didn't say, thanks. Thanks a lot. I only happen to be 33. How many people would be excited if you're around like 33 and someone was saying something like, you're not even 50. They said, absolutely, I'm not 50. Yeah, right. It took its toll on her. There was a woman in Luke 13. In Luke 13 in verse 10 to 13, as Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and it says, and behold, there was a woman which had the spirit of infirmity 18 years, and was bowed together, and could in no wise lift up herself. And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said unto her, Woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. Now, a lot of people will teach this and portray this woman as being filled with devils. But it doesn't say that. It says she had a spirit of infirmity. In other words, there was something spiritually wrong with her that brought upon her a physical malady. And it was to where, who knows, maybe she was like the woman in John chapter 4 there, who had, had a few more husbands than she was willing to kind of make known. And then at the time didn't have a habit to have a husband at all. And so some speculate that's why she was going to the well around high noon, because that's not the time. You read this back in the book of Genesis, somewhere around chapter 30 or so, you'll find that the women went and they, it was around 6 o'clock at night when they went and got the water. So here's this woman around high noon getting the water. Maybe she was going out at that time because she didn't want to run into the people. Maybe she was made fun of by all the other people in town. You say, oh, here comes old slutty whatever. And so she just went at a different time. Well, in this particular case, I don't know what this woman's problem was, but it says that she's all bent over. She couldn't straighten herself up. Do you ever notice how some people can't look you in the eye? They're always like down like this. Well, I would imagine if you've got a bad spirit about you, if you feel guilty about something and you can't look at somebody, there's a good possibility that you'll begin to kind of go around like this. And people will look, what are you looking at? Stop looking at me. And next thing you know, you'll find yourself down like this. All of a sudden say, hey, I can't straighten up here. And it's a spiritual matter that brought on a physical problem in your life. And don't say it can't happen, because it does happen. And Jesus helped this woman there. But there was a change in her appearance. And there was a change in her attitude. Because notice back in Ruth chapter 1 and verse 20, she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. See, she knew that she shouldn't have gone down there, shouldn't have been down there 10 years, shouldn't have allowed her sons to marry off into these heathen women and all. She was backslid, just like Lot going down to Sodom. He knew he was back. He may have stood in the gate of Sodom, but he knew he was backslidden character. He knew he was. He was probably putting on a show down there. And no doubt Naomi was backslid as well. The Bible says in Proverbs 14:14, the backslider in heart shall be filled with his own ways. She had become bitter. Now, the reason I'm saying this tonight is because just like we read that if you allow this, and that's what we talked about this morning, allowing something else to get in there besides the Word of God, lest any root of bitterness. See, some things went wrong in Naomi's life, a whole slew of them. But she didn't chalk it up. She wasn't like Job. Said, well, naked came I into the world, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord hath given, the Lord will take away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not charge God foolishly. See, she wasn't like that. She wasn't like Job. Her attitude was, they looked at her and they said, Naomi. Who is that, Naomi? And she is so bitter. She's got such an attitude. She said, don't call me Naomi. You call me Mara. Ooh, sorry, honey. See, Naomi means pleasant. When she left Bethlehem, Judah, she probably had a reputation of being a nice, sweet lady. But when she came back, and she said, don't you call me pleasant anymore, because I'm not. You call me Mara. You know what Mara means? Bitter. And so she was. What is a root, by the way? I'll tell you what a root is. It's the source of the plant. And when a root of bitterness springs up, there's something at the source. There's something at the source as to why she is this way. And we know what it was. God allowed a famine to come into her land. God allowed a famine to come into her life. And when it came in, she resented it. And she got mad at God. There's a lot of people mad at God, you know. And it's the cause for a root of bitterness. It's one thing to be mad at each other. But boy, when you get mad at God, like they say, you're barking up the wrong tree there. In Proverbs 21:9, the Bible said, it's better to dwell in the corner of the housetop than with a brawling woman in a wide house. This gal come back and man, she's hot. She's got a chip on her shoulder. She's got something down in her heart that is a root of bitterness. Proverbs 21:19 says it's better to dwell in the wilderness than with a contentious and an angry woman. I'm not against women here. I'm just telling you what God said about it. And the same thing would be true with a man. If you let bitterness and anger take root down in your heart and in your soul, God would say the same thing about you. You don't want to live with them. You don't want to be around them. Proverbs 25:24 says, it is better to dwell in the corner of the housetop than with a brawling woman in a wide house. And so we see the noticeable change. When you go away from God, when you allow yourself to develop this root of bitterness, and by the way, it was her own doing. I don't read anything in chapter number 1 where she said to Elimelech, honey, you want to go down there, help yourself, but I'm not. She never said that. Now, she probably would have followed him anyway, but she didn't voice her opposition. So we see the noticeable change. Bitterness in your life will change your attitude. You'll go from being very pleasant to very bitter. And guess what? People will notice it. It will, just like we read in Hebrews 12, it will spring up and trouble you, and it will defile everybody around you. People aren't going to want to be around you. So we see the noticeable change. Number 2, we see the nasty complaint. The nasty complaint. She blamed God for her suffering. Yeah, she did. Look at what it says there in verse 21. She said, I went out full. Well, that was a lie. She went out with a growling belly, didn't she? There was a famine in the land. It's amazing how we forget, isn't it? She's saying, I went out full, and the Lord hath brought me home again empty. Why then call ye me Naomi, seeing the Lord hath testified against me, and the Almighty hath afflicted me? She said, I went out, and I was full, and now I'm a pauper. Now I've got nothing. No husband, no sons, nothing. I got one heathen daughter-in-law that went back to her heathen gods. All I got is this picture. And I've got this one with me. Who knows how she's going to turn out? She had nothing more than the clothes on her back. You know, she's the female equivalent of the prodigal. If you think about it, she really is. She blamed God for her suffering. She blames God for her sorrow. She said, the Lord is against me in verse 21. He's against me? And that, if that's not bad enough, she goes on and says, and the Almighty hath afflicted me. You talk about a nasty complaint. Can you imagine making that charge against God? You're against me. And, well, the Bible does say that he's angry with the wicked every day. So maybe there was something to be said about that. But I think about this and I think, you know, we all tend to make these kinds of complaints. We cover up our own sin, our own wrongdoings, and we turn the table and we try to blame God for it. Back in Genesis chapter 3, remember when Adam and Eve, they were told, they had simple instructions, see the tree in the midst of the garden? Don't eat of that thing. In the day thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. Well, what'd they do? They ate of it. They ate of it. Now God's going to, now God says, okay, front and center. let's work this out now. The Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. Now on the surface, and we all say this, here's Adam, and he turns and he blames Eve. Blames the poor little sweet lovey wife. Unfortunately, if you read that more carefully, you'll realize he didn't blame Eve at all. He blamed God. It says there, the woman whom thou gavest to be with me. You set me up, God. You stuck me with her. If you'd have given me a better woman, I wouldn't have eaten of that thing. And here's God saying, you know, like the old expression, no good deed goes unpunished, right? So we see the nasty complaint. We've seen the noticeable change, the nasty complaint. But boy, we serve a good God. I want you to see this final point here, the never-ending compassion. The never-ending compassion. Notice what it says there. Now, she says it in such a fashion to where you can almost pick up on the negativity, but if you break it apart a little, she makes a statement that's quite encouraging. It says there in verse number 21, I went out full, and the Lord hath brought me home again empty. Let's forget about the empty part. Notice what she said. The Lord hath brought me home again. You talk about the never-ending compassion. Whenever I think of something like that, I always think of Peter. When Peter denied the Lord, and I forget which gospel account it's in, it might be in Mark, where when after the resurrection and the angels told the women there, you go and tell his disciples to meet me in Galilee. And he said, and tell Peter also. He incorporated that, tell Peter. Say, why would he say that? I'll tell you why. Because in Peter's mind, Peter would have said, he doesn't want me there. There's no, after what I did to him, you don't understand. When that cock crew, he looked me square in the face. I saw the hurt on his face, and I went out and I wept bitterly. It's what the Bible said I did. He knew he did it. And so God had to tell Peter specifically. Otherwise, Peter would have never gone. We might never know anything about Peter after that, except they said, and tell Peter to come too. And so that's what I read here. I read here that Naomi, even though she recognized, even though she wanted to blame God, she did make the statement, the Lord hath brought me home again. And I want to tell you tonight, God will bring you home if you want to come home. Oh yeah, she failed to recognize the goodness of God in her life. We have to recognize that he preserved, just like the prodigal. Even though he was in a hog pen, even though he was in a far country, God still preserved him through that so that one day he could come to himself. One day she did come to herself and decide to come on home.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, fundamental, King James Bible-believing church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus.